Friends, God bless you and welcome. This is a day that we celebrate unofficially as St. Patrick's Day. You know, St. Patrick was a saint, and he was there in Ireland. And I'll have a few more things to say about that, but I see the wearing of the green here. If you're wearing green, are you really Irish? Some say yes. You know, it's a hard thing to get Lutherans from Germany or Sweden to say they have any Irish connection. But if you do, oh, that's great. So here we are on this fifth Sunday of Lent. Do you know what next week will begin? Holy Week. Passion Palm Sunday next week. And then we have Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and then Easter. Amazing to me that we're moving along in that way. But we thank God for the presence of Jesus in our lives, in our world. And we are thankful indeed that we can be here and listen together to God's Word. You might have received, and I hope you did, maybe a handout that said St. Patrick's breastplate. Did you get that little piece? I'd like us to look at that and perhaps as a way of beginning today to think about St. Patrick. We could share that together. We have that? And we'll just read that together if we could. I gotta get to the right place. So here we are. Christ with me, Christ before me, Christ behind me, Christ in me, Christ beneath me, Christ above me, Christ on my right, Christ on my left, Christ when I lay down, Christ when I sit down, Christ when I rise, Christ in the heart of everyone who thinks of me, Christ in the mouth of everyone who speaks of me, Christ in every eye that sees me, Christ in every ear that hears me. I arise today through a mighty strength and invocation of the Trinity, through the belief in the threeness, through confession of oneness of our Creator of the creation. Amen. Well, thank you very, very much. You know, our communion will be at this kneeling rail, and you can kneel or stand if you like. But that's how we'll be doing it today. And once again, after the reading of the gospel, I'll be wanting to talk to our children who are here, and it's just always so nice to have children with us. You need the worship addendum to be able to have the confession and forgiveness that we have in a musical setting. Dave Lutz, in our fellowship time, is going to continue with his study, and that's downstairs in the lounge. And I want to say again that next week is our Passion. And when we get to Thursday, Holy Thursday, we're going to have our liturgy downstairs in the lounge. It'll be different for us. And I tell you what we're going to do. We're going to have a special time for digging down into the Last Supper. What it means, the fellowship that Jesus had with his disciples there in Passover. And there's a lot of significance, and we'll meet down there for about an hour. And I think you'll be inspired and you gain new insight to that first Last Supper. Oh, I see. This is important. Order for Easter flowers. What does it do? Today, right now. So if you didn't do it, I hope you have a check with you or you have an IOU or something, you can say, please, please help me. Okay, friends, let's listen to our music this morning and pray God's blessing. as our processional hymn is my song, is Love on Hill, hymn number 94. And you'll notice there are more row verses than just on one page. So 94, and we stand.
Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. You have given grace to your servant Patrick, to whom you gave gifts to make the gospel news known to a people of Ireland. Raise up, we pray, in every country, heralds and evangelists of your kingdom, so the world may know the immeasurable richnesses of our Savior, Jesus Christ, our Lord, one God, now and forever.
First reading for the day is from Jeremiah, chapter 31. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, a covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another, or say to each other, Know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord, for I will forgive their iniquities and remember their sin no more. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
second reading is from Hebrews, chapter 5. So also did Christ not glorify himself in the beginning in becoming a high priest, but was appointed by the one who said to him, "You are my son. Today I have begotten you." As he also says in another place, "You are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek." In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the ones who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered. And having been made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him, having been designated by God a high priest according to the order of Melchizedek. The word of the Lord.
Savior Jesus Christ, according to St. John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Now, among those who went up to worship at the festival were some Greeks. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and said to him, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." Philip went and told Andrew. Then Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honor. Now my soul is troubled, and what should I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, it was for this reason that I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came from heaven, "I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again." The crowd standing there heard it and said that it was thunder. Others said, "An angel has spoken to him." Jesus answered, "This voice has come for your sake, not for mine. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself." He said this to indicate the kind of death he was to die. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. And I'd like to invite our young folks everywhere. I want to tell you, my sermon today is in three parts to satisfy the Holy Trinity idea. But the first part is with our children who are coming over here. And it has to do with the teaching of St. Patrick. You know about that teaching, of course, of the shamrock. And I want to just show you, here I have shamrock, sitting down right here, that's great. And the teaching from St. Patrick about this plant. He told people, as he was talking about God, he said, if you look at a shamrock plant, let's say you pick one of the shamrocks, how's your counting doing? Can you count 1, 2, 3 leaves? 1, 2, 3. Yes, he's counted. Okay, there's 3 leaves, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And then you see this one stem, one stem, and that means God as a stem. God is one, but three: Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And that was a teaching that we have that persists to this day about the Holy Trinity: Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So I'm giving this shamrock to you on this St. Patrick's Day. You're welcome. Okay, you are so welcome. You can go back to your seat. Okay. Thanks for coming. God bless you. So now you know the first part of the sermon, one teaching from St. Patrick. Okay, you heard that before, didn't you? Three in one? One in three? Yeah. That's our teaching of the faith, and St. Patrick has helped us along the way to remember that. And always, we're remembering Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, the Holy Trinity, that name in which we were baptized. Long enough for that one part. Oh, let's try a second part. And that has to do with our gospel today. Did you hear that beginning where some Greek said, "We want to see Jesus"? Very important phrase. And I think I've told you all this before. Well, I'll tell you. Here on this pulpit, there is the same message embedded here in bronze, and the words are, "Sir, we would see Jesus." And through the years, whomever your pastors have been preaching from here, I bet you they rub their hands over that, it's pretty shiny. And they, hopefully, were helping you see Jesus. That's the point of this, isn't it? That together we get to see Jesus. Sir, we would see Jesus. Beautiful, beautiful. But I'm not going to stay there, because I know you want to see Jesus. And how is it that we see Jesus? How do we see Jesus? Well, there are several ways in which you and I see Jesus. We see Jesus as we come together in the family of God, because believers have this sign among them that Jesus is with us always. So that's one of the signs that we have from Jesus, who said, "I'll be with you always to the end of the age." We also see Jesus as we come to receive the body and blood of Jesus. That is Jesus for us. And those of us who want to see Jesus can receive that small amount of bread and that small amount of wine and say, "I do believe that that is the precious body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ." That's what's given to you. That's what we believe. And Luther said it in this way: "In, with, and through the bread and wine, Jesus is real for us." So we say a real presence of Jesus. That's one way. In the Word is one way. In the community that gathers here is a way that Jesus is noticed and seen. I want to tell you a third matter that is so very important about seeing Jesus. You know, since we are all believers in the faith, and I'm going to cough. Since we're all believers in the faith, have been baptized, as I look into your eyes, I believe Jesus is looking back at me. As I look into your eyes, Jesus looks back at me, because his presence is real in each one of us. And so as you look at me and you say, "Oh, Pastor, I look into your eyes, am I looking at Jesus?" Well, yes, that is the presence of Jesus for each one of us. It's a way in which he communicates himself. Oh, there's some other ways: by using our hands, our feet to go somewhere and help another person. Jesus is all around doing things. And so when we are like those Greeks who said, "We wish to see Jesus," well, today we can say with St. Patrick, "Oh, in the shamrock." We have that teaching, three in one, one in three. We can be with those who have traveled with Jesus through the centuries, who have wanted to be a part of that body of Christ, who have taken time to worship, to receive him, and then, extending from that, we have a third point of each of us becomes a sign of Jesus for another. Do you look at another person and think that Jesus could be looking at you? It's the only eyes he has. It's the only hands he has. Oh, your voice is used for Jesus, because your voice can speak the word of God, the truth that sets us free. You can walk somewhere and help another person, and just in your movement and your way of being, you are a person who Jesus is using to communicate himself to another person. Such an important teaching we have today about wanting to see and being able to see Jesus. And then we have the wonderful Old Testament reading that says, you know, all of us are going to know the word of God in our hearts. It'll be written on our hearts. And so for you and you and you and me and everyone, we know the word because God's given it to us, so that we can say to another person in love, what's happening to you today? How might I reach out and help you? And that'll be another one of those signs of seeing Jesus. In that Hebrews reading, we have the high priest Melchizedek. Oh, such a word we never hear except there. And he is a priest by God forever. And so when Hebrews says, oh, Christ, Jesus is like Melchizedek, it means Jesus is forever our high priest. And we believe that as well, that Jesus is always going to be before the Father, seeking that we would have forgiveness of our sins through his precious blood there at Calvary. And of course, next week in our Holy Week, we'll be celebrating all those ways that Jesus has been showing us his ultimate love and giving his life for the life of the world. And that means our lives as well, that we have a rich, wonderful inheritance in Jesus. We can be taught together about God, three in one. We can be people who believe that he is here and communicating himself to us. And we can believe that we are the body of Christ in the world in many different ways. So I thank you for wanting to be here. I thank you for wanting to be that sign of Jesus in our world. So when you look at another person today, you could look at that person through your eyes as though you have the compassion and the love of Jesus coming out of you, just streaming out of you with love. That's the essence, isn't it, of our faith, that giving and sharing of that love. And on St. Patrick's Day, may that bless you. Amen. Friends, we stand together as we turn to the Nicene Creed, a statement of our faith. We believe in one God, Father, Thank you.
the season of Lent, we look at the cost of our redemption. We acknowledge that our money, our bodies, and our time belong to God. We relinquish our desire to cover up our own unrighteousness. We humbly and joyfully claim God's promise of eternal life.
Merciful God, we thank you for your supreme sacrifice and for welcoming us into the fellowship of believers. We bow in gratitude, awed by the magnitude of your love and grace. Teach us to give back to you all that we are and all that we have, that we may praise you with our whole lives, and that we may become living sacrifices to you through Jesus Christ our Lord. Be assured, your sins are forgiven in the name of Jesus our Lord. Trusting in God's promise to reconcile all things, let us pray for the church, the well-being of creation, and a world in need. God of the covenant, through the church, you draw us into community. We give thanks for the means of grace around which we gather. Inspire writers, musicians, and artists whose creative gifts adorn our worship. Lord, in your mercy. God of all that exists, you lavish the earth with extravagant beauty. Preserve the rich and complex diversity of living things. Support local, national, and international efforts to protect the environment for future generations. Lord, in your mercy. God of the nations, you desire peace and plenty for all people. Defend those who challenge oppression and expose corruption. Support advocates for human rights, social justice, and the welfare of children. Lord, in your mercy. God of goodwill, you restore what is broken. We pray that any experiencing estrangement, conflict, or abuse in families and in their relationships, protect all and comfort all who are vulnerable, especially those living in institutions. Lord, in your mercy. God of every time and place, you are with us. Support ministries of prayer and presence in this congregation. Move us to reach out to any who are homebound, lonely, grieving, in treatment, or ill, especially those on our prayer and concern list. Lord, in your mercy. Lord Jesus, we trust in the forgiving grace poured out in your sacrificial death and resurrection. Help us believe and not waver in our commitment to you. Lord, in your mercy. Give hope to people in Gaza that the continuing food and
supplies and airlift operations underway will increase with land operations. We pray especially for the Holy Land and also Ukraine. We cry out for peace. Lord, in your mercy. In times of quiet prayer, we offer our hopes and dreams for your will, for people, for so much. Lord, in your mercy. O God of mercy, grant to all those who are suffering healing and comfort, especially refugees and others who are fleeing terror and unbelievable conditions. Lord, in your mercy. O gracious God, please help those who have much to share and help those who have so little. Lord, in your mercy. God of tolerance, please help us to accept all of our brothers and sisters as equals and end hatred and intolerance. Lord, in your mercy. God of promise, we give thanks for the saints whose faith inspires us, especially Patrick, missionary to Ireland, whom we commemorate today. Grant us faith to trust in your everlasting love. Lord, in your mercy.
Accompany us on our journey, God of grace, and receive the prayers of our hearts. We ask this through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Peace be with you. We should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, almighty and merciful God, through our Savior, Jesus Christ. You call your people to cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Easter feast, that renewed in the gift of holy baptism, we may come to the fullness of grace. And so, with all the choirs of angels and with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. mercy for our fallen world, you gave your only Son, that all those who believe in him should not perish, but have eternal life. And we give you thanks and praise, O Lord, not as we ought, but as we are able, for the salvation you have prepared for us through Jesus Christ. Send now your Holy Spirit into our hearts, that we may receive our Lord with a living faith as he comes to us in his Holy Supper. It was in the night in which he was betrayed that our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. He blessed it and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, given and shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Now we ask you to join our prayers of those of your servants at every time and every place, and unite them with the ceaseless petitions of a great high priest until he comes as victorious Lord of all. Let us pray. precious body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you unto everlasting life. Until we meet again, may God hold you in the palm of his hands. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.